Greetings, fellow PLSQL developers. My name is Stephen Feuerstein, and I'm an architect on applied PLSQL at Oracle Corporation, and I still can barely believe it. Joined about 6 months ago, and it's an exciting time to be back at Oracle. So feel free to contact me at my email address, check out my blog, check out my Twitter feed, and all that great stuff. But today, right now, what I'm going to talk to you about is bulletproofing your PLSQL, because sometimes, maybe just occasionally, things don't go precisely as planned. So bulletproofing PLSQL. Yes, the number one fantasy in software development. Everything's going to go just like we plan it. The way I think we generally think about this in our head is that this time we're going to get it right. This time, contrary to every past experience, it's all going to work smoothly and according to plan. And to do that, the users have to give us accurate specifications. The users have to use our application properly. And of course, there are no bugs in our code, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So that's our fantasy, and as usual, not much connection with reality. Let's face it, if you want to write high-quality applications that are actually popular with our users, and that's pretty important, we need to anticipate problems, assume that things will go wrong, and then make our code as much as possible bulletproof. So what I'm going to do is take you on a trip through a lot of the features in PLSQL to help you achieve that, mostly related to error management, but not entirely. And I'll offer some recommendations for how best to incorporate these features into your code. Now I'm going to be running a number of scripts or showing you the code, and all the code I show you is available in my demo zip file, which is available at the PLSQL Learning Library, part of the Oracle Learning Library. So go to oracle.com/OLL, do a search on PLSQL, and you'll find the PLSQL Learning Library and download my demo zip. So you can run all this code on your own, in your own environments, verifying what I'm showing you and also getting more familiar with these features and how to apply them. So what's all that we can talk about? We'll touch on handling exceptions, and look at the built-in functionality in DBMS utility and util call stack, where and how to best handle those exceptions. We'll touch on for all with save exceptions, in other words, suppressing errors at the statement level. Now, I won't be talking in detail about the for all bulk processing feature, but focus mainly on the error handling side of things. I'll make sure you know about log errors for DML, which allows you to suppress errors at the row level, which is really quite remarkable and a good thing to be aware of, though I don't think you'll use it all that often. I'll touch on the after server error trigger, which offers a form of instance-wide error handling. And then moving away from the features built into PLSQL, I want to talk about the importance of validating assumptions and using assertion routines to do that to avoid any kinds of surprises. But of course, there will be surprises. So you also need to trace execution of your code to make it easier to diagnose bugs. In other words, answer the question, how did that happen? That's a lot to cover. Let's get going. So, handling exceptions. Something's gone wrong in your code. It could have been because a user entered something wrong. It could have been because of a bug, but an exception has been raised. And we can create the single exception section that will consolidate all the error handling logic in a block, which is a really nice way to organize this. Remember, though, that the exception section can only handle errors that are raised in the executable section of the block. So if an error is raised assigning a default value for a variable in the declaration section, it always goes out unhandled to the enclosing block. So we'll touch on SQL code and SQL error message. I'm sure you're all quite familiar with them. SQL code returns the current error code. SQL error message returns the current error message. And oddly enough, Oracle suggests that you not use SQL error message. I'll come back to that. DBMS utility format call stack answers the question, how did I get there? DBMS utility format error stack answers the question, what was the error? Essentially, that's the replacement for SQL error message. And DBMS utility format error backtrace, probably the most important of this trio, answers the question, where in my code was the error raised? What line number? And finally, new to 12.1, so if you're on Oracle Database 12c, Oracle now provides a new built-in package, util call stack, that essentially replaces or supersedes all this functionality. In some cases, simply creating or reproducing the same capabilities. In some cases, adding some nice new features that I'll talk about on the next page. But why don't I just take a little bit of time exploring these different functions? Now, you'll see on this page a block with the names of files inside them. These are some of the files that I'll be using to demonstrate these features, and we may even touch on some others. Off we go to SQL Developer. So let's take a look first at the call stack. So here's a call to DBMS utility format call stack, and it's called format call stack because it formats the execution call stack, which means A calls B calls C, or maybe it was D calls E calls Q calls C. And obviously, when you've got an issue that you're trying to track down, knowing how you got there in your code, what path was taken, is pretty darn important. So I create procedure proc 1 that calls format call stack. It's called from proc 2, and proc 2 is called from proc 3. Now let's take a look at what happens when we run this. I'll make sure my DBMS output is enabled. Run my script. And we look at the output. And here is the format call stack. So as you can see, it's quite formatted. It gives you the object handle, which nobody cares about. It gives you the line number in the code of the entry point. And it gives you the name of the program that was called. So proc 3, called proc 2, called proc 1. Now, you might be looking at what I just pointed at and saying, wait a minute, Stephen, it doesn't say that proc 3 called proc 2. It says proc 3 called package 1. And that's true. So in util call stack, sorry, in DBMS utility format call stack, the call stack information only goes down to the program unit name. In other words, package 1. It doesn't show you, though we'd really like it to show us, proc 2. That's something that we have, that Oracle has addressed. I can say it, that we've addressed in 12.1. But that's the basic idea. You call this function, it returns the call stack, and usually what you'll do is log it into a table. So I use call stack when I'm tracing execution and when I'm logging errors, and I simply have a column in my log table called the call stack. I dump it in there, and when I need to look at it, I pull it out. Okay, let's take a look at the error stack. First of all, we'll start with error message. SQL error message has been around forever. I'm sure you all use it, which is why many people are surprised when I say, we recommend that you not use it. I'll come back to that. SQL error message in its generic form, calling it with no arguments, returns the error message associated with the current error in your session. But you can also pass it an error code, and it will display the error message for that code. It's a generic lookup program. Now, as a replacement for SQL error message, Oracle offers DBMS utility format error stack. And it pretty much returns the same information, except that in some cases, if the error stack gets very long, SQL error message will truncate, whereas format error stack will not truncate until a much larger string. That's really the only difference between them. Okay, so let's go ahead and try this out. So I'll call SQL error message for the default or the current error. I'll ask it to look up the error message number, the error message for that number, and we don't need to show that it only works with negatives. That's the case. And then we'll call format error stack. That doesn't look right. Let's clear that out. Let's run that again. Oh, that was right. Let's run it again. So I looked at the output and I thought, exact fetch returns more than requested number of rows. I wasn't running a query, but of course, what I did was raise the too many rows exception. So there's the error message. Here's the lookup for that error message, and it's the same. And then DBMS utility format error stack also looks exactly the same. So in most cases, you're not going to see a difference between error message and format error stack. If you have a long recursive calling of programs and they raise exceptions back through the stack, then you can hit the limit. I'll show you that in a second. Let's see. So let's see if I can find that file. Big error stack. So in this block of code, I've got show errors, and that will show me both the error message string and the format error stack string along with their length. Then I have a program called raise error that recursively calls itself 10,000 times. And then at the end, raises an exception and backs out the exception all the way out. I'll trap the exception, show the errors, run my script, look at the output. And what you can see is that SQL error message truncates at 510. and you can see it right here. It's fully truncated. Format error stack stopped at 1027, and you can see it went all the way down to the no data found. I'm not really sure if this is a truncation taking place. It's clearly not 10,000 lines in the stack, but it does get you to the bottom of the stack, which is really important. That's where the error started. So if you're running into problems with really long error messages, or really long error stacks, I should say, make sure you switch over to format error stack. And now let's take a look at backtrace, which is arguably the most important of any of them. So I've got proc 3 calling proc 2, proc 2 calls proc 1, proc 1 raises an exception. Notice there are no exception handlers, so it comes all the way out, and then we'll see what an unhandled exception looks like. So I'm going to open up another window. I'll use this one. Run my script. And here, that's the output. But what we want to see is the unhandled exception. So it came all the way out unhandled. And notice, it shows me the line number on which the error occurred. Now, prior to Oracle 10.2, so a long time ago, Oracle 10G release 2, this was the only way you could see that line number, is if you let the exception go entirely unhandled, which is not an optimal situation. So what Oracle did back in 10.2 was add the format error backtrace program. So let's replace proc 3 with this new version. So everything else we get rid of, new proc 3. So now when proc 2 raises an exception, we'll look at the error stack and the error backtrace, and then we'll call proc 3. So I run my script. And I look at the output. And now we see the error stack, which is the error message. And here's the backtrace. And you can see the backtrace is the same, back to line 5 on proc 1. So backtrace and format error stack are critical functions to call whenever you're handling an exception, so that you can find out where the error took place, where it originated, and what the error message was. Great stuff. Now, one other point to keep in mind about backtrace is that if you're going to handle an exception and then re-raise it, if you call backtrace after the re-raise, it only traces back to that last raise. So what you want to do is, whenever you log an error, call backtrace at that point, save it in your table, and then re-raise, and you're okay. You've got that original error information. So these are the functions that have been around since at least 10.2, and they're very helpful. In 12.1, Oracle added a new package. Let's take a look. So util call stack provides a much more granular API to the call stack and the backtrace. For example, and the most important thing really, is that you can now get the full name information down to a nested subprogram unit in terms of where you are in the call stack. In general, and the API gives you the ability to parse those different elements and pull out very minute parts of the stacks, which can be helpful, but in general, all you're going to be doing is sending this information out to a table and then looking at it after that. So, before I move on, let's take a look at util call stack. So, util call stack offers a much more complex, really, and useful API. So, for example, I can get the subprogram at the top of the stack. And then I can say concatenate subprogram to put together all the names and subnames inside the program unit. And then when I trace execution, I can actually see that subname. And I've already run this, so let's take a look. Can I get you up here? Yes. So here's the call stack. This is what you see prior to 12.1. And in 12.1 and higher, you can see this information, that the second call was to package 1, proc 1, nested in proc 1. That's a nested subprogram. So package 1, proc 1, nested in proc 1. So we now give you the ability to get all that detailed information and was never available before by using this API. Now, having said that, I feel kind of uncomfortable giving you this great functionality, and it's really great, and I'm glad we put it in there, but having you do all this work to figure out how to use concatenate subprogram and so on and so forth. So one of the things you'll find in DemoZip, I can move back over, is the util call stack helper file. So in the util call stack helper, I've basically created a little API on top of, sorry about that, on top of the util call stack package. So instead of you having to put together all those different program names, I'll now do it for you. You just call these high-level programs, and I do all the work of calling the different API elements. Now, I'm not saying you shouldn't learn how to use util call stack, but my feeling is that your time is probably going to be better spent by focusing on your user requirements and less so on understanding the APIs of our built-in packages. Okay. Back to the world of PowerPoint. So where and how should you use all these different functions and APIs? Now, some people might argue that you should have every single exception handler should call all these different functions. So whenever you have a when clause, call backtrace, call stack, call format error stack, I would suggest that you not do that. That you do not call each of these different functions, exposing them at the program level. Instead, create a generic error logging utility, call the logger inside each handler, pass application-specific information. This is an important point. We can grab through our function calls, the error stack, the call stack, the backtrace. It's all very generic. But we don't know which variables in your program are critical to diagnosing your problem. Those are things you need to pass in to your logging utility and throw them into your table. And that's why it's extremely important to have each of these exception handlers calling the generic procedure, putting the data in the table, not writing it yourself individually. Now, the next question is, at what level should you trap those questions? Some people argue for only having an exception section at the outermost block, so you don't have to write them all over the place. The errors bubble up to that top level. You call the generic functions. They give you all this information. And that's compelling. And it's certainly easier and simpler for developers. I'm not so certain I like that, though. Here's the problem, or the alternative. Trap exceptions in the block where they are raised. In the block where they are raised, not at the top level. What's the key advantage? Well, certainly it's more work for you as an individual developer having to add the exception section and calling, hopefully just calling the generic error logger, so it's not that big a deal. But the big thing again is that you can then trap or you can grab application-specific information, the values of local variables, the state of your tables, the state of packages inside your session. We can't get that for you automatically, at least not yet. So you have to do that yourself, and you have to decide what you want to log. If you let the exception come out of the current block where the variables are declared and trapped only at a higher level, you will lose those local variables. Oracle will automatically clean them up. So I suggest being fairly granular about where you trap your exceptions if there's local data that you need to grab and save. Okay, so I've covered a number of the basic functions and things that you should think about when you're handling exceptions. Now what I want to do is take a look at some specific features of SQL and PLSQL and how they relate to error handling. The first is for all. So for all is part of the bulk processing subsystem or set of features of PLSQL. And essentially, whenever you have a loop and inside that loop you have DML statements, inserts, updates, or deletes, then you should switch to bulk collect and for all to process that data. Unfortunately, in the context of this webinar, I can't cover that. You should definitely check out my other webinars on performance. But typically, certainly, for all statements execute a large number of DML statements, maybe thousands and thousands of DML statements that only differ by the bind values. Now, when an exception occurs in any of those DML statements, the default behavior is what you'd expect. The statement, that individual statement, one of tens of thousands, is rolled back, and the for all itself stops. But remember that any previously successfully completed statements are not rolled back. So if I'm executing 10,000 updates and I got through 5,000, and the 5,001st update failed, the first 5,000 updates are still in the session. The changes are still waiting to be committed or rolled back. Only the 5,001st statement has been rolled back. Now, that might be just what you want. If so, you're done. But in many cases when we're working with for all, we're doing bulk processing of those statements, so we might want the processing to continue to completion. I've got 10,000 DML statements that need to be processed. Go for all go, and don't stop, even if you get an error. I want you to keep going until you're finished. How can we achieve that? Just add the exceptions or save exceptions clause. My apologies, this should be save exceptions as you're about to see in the code. First of all, just to give you a quick look at for all statements. So here's my for all statement with the delete inside of it. And I'm basically populating an array and then iterating through the elements of that array and executing this delete statement for 138 and 147. You can even have multiple bind arrays that are correlated, and then you can use them in your updates, your inserts, deletes, etc. Now, save exceptions. So you've seen the basic for all statement. Here's an example of using for all and then adding the save exceptions clause. And what that does is essentially tell Oracle to save the exception information and keep on going. So Oracle saves the information, processes all of your DML statements, and when the for all statement is finished, when all the statements have been completed, if at least one exception occurred, then Oracle raises the -24381 error. Now, Oracle has not given a name to this error code, though I think they should. We should. But you can still trap it and handle it. So let's take a look at how you would do that. Because what Oracle does very nicely is give you a pseudo collection. It looks like an array in PL/SQL, but it's somewhat constrained in its definition. And you can iterate through that collection to find out what went wrong. So here's the addition of save exceptions. There's my DML statement. Now, if I didn't have save exceptions and I ran this code, then we come down to the one others clause and we could see format error stack. In fact, let's give that a try. My table should be all ready to go. No, I'm not sure about that. I don't think I have employees in the schema I'm connected to. So we'll just take a look at the code. So without the save exceptions, as soon as it hits an error, it'll stop and we can see what the error message was. But if I add save exceptions, then when it's all done, when all the statements have been attempted, then Oracle will raise the -24381. Now, you could write code that looks like this. When others, then if SQL code equals 24381, I strongly suggest that you not do that. That is a very obscure piece of code, and it will make people feel bad. They'll say to themselves, wow, I guess Steven was really smart. He sure knew PL/SQL, but I didn't know it. And I'm not sure if I should touch this code. It makes me afraid of the code. You should write code that doesn't make people afraid to touch it. You should write code that makes people feel welcome. Here's how you do it. Create an exception of your own. Use the pragma exception init, the command to the compiler to associate that exception with this Oracle code. And then I can trap by name. This is exactly what Oracle does to define things like no data found and dupe valid index, zero divide, and so on. So you can do it yourself. So never hard code an Oracle error number in your application. Now, once I trap the exception, I can see the error stack, the error message, and then I can iterate through all the elements in my bulk exceptions collection. And it's a collection of records. So there's an error index on what row in the collection did the error occur. And the error code tells me what the error was, the error number. And I can use SQL error message to look up the error code or the error message for that error code. But notice, you have to multiply by -1 because there's still some confusion or difference of opinion inside Oracle. Some people think that error codes are negative. Some people treat them as positives. SQL error message definitely thinks they should be negative. The error code that's trapped and stored by bulk exceptions by the save exceptions clause just treats them as positive numbers. In any case, iterate through the collection, grab the information. You might say, if the error code equals -17, then I want to attempt a recovery. Otherwise, write it to the log table. Call the log program, whatever is appropriate. Next, let's touch on a really interesting feature, row-level suppression of errors with log errors. So default behavior regarding DML statements is that they're all or nothing. So let's go back to for all to drive this point home. Remember I said that if I'm updating, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 rows, if I'm updating 6 rows, the first 2 rows will be done successfully. The third row will fail because the length of that name is too big. So this statement, the third statement using this value, will be rolled back. But the previous statements would not. And second of all, if inside my update statement, some of my rows could be updated, but some could not be, then all of them would be rolled back. You can't have partially saved rows of information unless you use log errors. So that's the basic idea behind log errors. If you add log errors to your DML statement, you can preserve changes to rows within that single statement. And this is the only way I know of to do this. This is really going deep inside the SQL layer and tinkering around with it, asking it to do things differently. When an error occurs, rather than filling up a collection, Oracle writes the information out to an error table that's defined through a call to the built-in package DBMS error log. So there are a few things that you really want to keep in mind using log errors. First, I don't think this is on the list. First is, do you really want this behavior? DML statements are generally always all or nothing. So you're really changing the way that SQL is behaving in your session. Make sure that's really what you want. First, and then, be very aware that no exception is raised when the statement finishes. With for all, when if at least one statement failed, Oracle raises that negative 24381. It stops the block from continuing. Not the case with log errors. It simply writes the information out to the table. And you have to take responsibility after that SQL statement finishes to look at the table and find out if there's anything in it. In other words, did anything go wrong? The other thing that's kind of a drag, but we can fix it, is the error log table is missing some information. It's missing some key information. Fortunately, we can add it. All right, so let's take a look. Now, I apologize. I'd already mentioned that I don't think I have the employees table here. Let me just verify that. Bring up those tables. And I think if I don't, that's all right. I'll just go over to my VM. Okay, so let's go through the steps. First of all, here's the command to create an error log. And let's make sure we don't have one there already. So there's the employees table, but nothing else. So let's create, whoops, I didn't want you, but that's all right. Let's see what our data is. There's our data. Excellent. Okay, so the first thing I'm going to do is create the error log. Yes, yes, yes. So create the error log. Let's take a look at our list of tables. And where's my table? Okay, I thought it would have created it. Why did it not? Maybe I'm not refreshing this properly. Let's look at the schema browser. Tables, there it is. So here's the error dollar employees table. So what Oracle has done is create a new table with five columns. They're always the same. The error number, the error message, the row ID, the operation type, the tag. And then for every column that is compatible with, is implicitly convertible to varchar 2, it creates the same name column with a varchar 2 4000. Great. And as you can see, the table is now empty. Okay, let's go down through here. Now, let's grab this script here. And what I'm going to do is try to give everybody a really big raise, a 200 times increase in salary. We'll find out how many people are making at least 24,000. We'll try to do this really big fat update, and then we'll see when we're done whether anybody has that salary now. I run my script. And it says before, nobody was making that much money, and after, nobody was making that much money. And look, we had an error. For at least one of the rows, the value was larger than the specified precision allowed. Now, it could be that nobody can get a times 200 salary, but let's find out. So what I'm going to do is take that same script, but I'm going to add log errors. So notice I've added log errors, reject limit, unlimited. I don't care how many problems we have along the way, just keep on going. I've also removed the exception section. And when I run this script, notice that no error was raised. But if I look at the output, now it says before nobody was making more than 24,000, and afterwards, 49 people are now making that much money. So 49 out of 107 rows could be updated. And because I used log errors, it was able to do those 49 changes and keep them and just reject the errors for the other 68. And notice no exception was raised. So the question is, where is that information? Let's go back here. Let's refresh. There's the data. So the error number was 1438. Again, positive, not negative. What can I say? Error message, row ID, update, operation type. And here are the values in the table at the time the update was attempted. And you can see the salary is just way too big for the constraint on this column for all of these. Really powerful, useful stuff if you want to do these kind of partial updates or partial DML operations. So the only way to get inside that individual statement and suppress errors at the row level is using log errors. There are a number of drawbacks to the implementation. One is that actually the table itself is missing some key data. Specifically, let's go back to the columns. It tells me what the error number is, the row ID, the message, but it doesn't tell me when the error occurred. It doesn't tell me where in my code it occurred. It doesn't tell me what the name of my user is when the error was generated. Those are pretty big gaps to have in an error log table, but have no fear. If you take a look at the demo zip, file and check out the DBMS error log helper script, you'll find the following. So what I've done is build a package. Look, I've even documented it. Wow, that's so exciting. I built a package, again, a helper package on top of the built-in functionality so that after you create your error log table using the standard built-in, I then use dynamic DDL to add columns to the table, who created it, when was it created, and give me the call stack. Then I create a trigger. Populate those columns with these values, calling the user function, sysdate, and of course, format call stack. I also create a package that you can use to look at the contents of the table and so on. But the main thing is that, well, there are a couple of lessons here. One is that, and the most important for me in general regarding Oracle technology, is that we write a lot of really fantastic stuff. I hope you will agree. But, you know, we're humans just like everybody else. Sometimes we get started with some really great idea and don't quite finish it. And sometimes there's not much you can do to fill the gap. But a lot of other times, there is something you can do. In this case, for whatever reason, the DBMS error log table doesn't have some key information, but it's just a persistent relational table, so you can add to it. And I hope that you will. And the best way to do it is just take advantage of my helper package and give yourself a break, let you focus on your building of implementing your user requirements. Moving on, another error-related piece of functionality inside Oracle is the after server error trigger. In theory, it sounds great. In practice, you're unlikely to use it. But in theory, it allows you to have a single table and a single procedure that you can use for exception handling in your entire instance. So the after server error is defined on the instance, and any exception that goes unhandled can be trapped by this trigger. So what's wrong? What could be the drawbacks for that? Well, let's see. First of all, the error has to go unhandled out of your PLSQL block for the trigger to kick in. So you have to let it bubble up to the top. A lot of times we don't really like to do that. It doesn't fire for all errors. For example, negative 600, negative 1403, no data found, negative 1422, which I think is too many rows. Those are interesting. The last two of those are interesting because minus 1403, no data found, we would often think of as not actually being an error, just a different data condition. And that's kind of recognized by this trigger. Generally speaking, this feature is most useful for non-PLSQL frontends that execute SQL statements directly. So it gives you a way on the database side to get a handle on what the heck is going on in that front end. So if you've got Java applications, JavaScript, who knows out there, just executing SQL directly, then this at least gives you a way to find out what's going wrong and calling backtrace and call stack and so on, and then being able to do that diagnosis more effectively. But for those of us who are building database-centric applications, building code on top of our tables, on top of our SQL, building Application Express or whatever, calling the APIs that we've constructed in PLSQL, you're very unlikely to want to use after server error. All right, so now I've covered a lot of the functionality that I wanted to touch on in this talk. I'm going to focus now more on some different approaches you can take in how you write your code to bulletproof them. And the first part of it is to bulletproof your blocks, the actual block structure. So as I'm sure you know, every block of PL/SQL has the following same structure. A declaration section, which is always optional, except for a package specification. An execution section, which is usually required for procedures and functions in anonymous blocks, but not for package bodies. And the exception section, which is also optional, and too optional, I suppose, since most of us just leave it off. But if you think about the structure of the code you write, not the structure of PL/SQL, it's often a bit different. For example, I would say that in general, let's just pull up all these, whoops, sorry, going way too fast. In general, whenever we're writing a piece of code, the first part of our execution section is initializing variables, checking parameter values, making sure everything's ready to go. So the initialization stage, then we have our application code. And then at the end, we should, though we often don't, partly because Oracle does so much of this for us, we should clean up after ourselves. Now again, Oracle does do most of the cleanup for us, but in some cases not. We might have been working with a file, we need to make sure we close it. We might have been working with package level variables that will retain their state. Maybe we want to clean those up. So conceptually, I think that this is a very common pattern, but it's not in the PL/SQL language itself. But that's okay. You can put it in the language by using nested subprograms, one of my absolute top favorite features in PLSQL. So inside any declaration section, you can create your own procedures, functions, etc. These would go on the bottom of your declaration section, and these can only be called from within the execution and exception sections. But it gives you a great way to organize your code to make it more manageable in general. And specifically in this context, you could set as a rule in your organization that every procedure and function has to have its own internal initialize procedure. It has to have its own internal cleanup procedure. The initialize procedure is a great way to isolate all that related functionality and clean up, actually, make it easier to see the main body of code that you're executing, that you're building. The cleanup program is really helpful to create because you want to call it at the end of a successful execution, but you also want to call it inside your exception handlers, and you don't want to copy and paste the code. So, as part of your bulletproofing process, I suggest you take this as a standard. Every procedure or function of any non-trivial complexity has its own initialization procedure, its own cleanup procedure. But that's not all. So, every time you write a program, that program makes assumptions. Your assumption might be that there's data in the table. How many of us have spent hours and hours banging our heads against the wall trying to figure out what's wrong with our code, and oh my gosh, I forgot to commit the change to the table. So that's one kind of assumption that happens a lot. Another assumption might be that the parameters that are coming into the procedure are always not null. In other words, if you're using my program correctly, nothing should come in as null. That's a big assumption to make. And the problem is that when an assumption is violated, especially when you have not explicitly thought about that assumption, programs can break down in ways that are difficult to diagnose. So basically, you might be two-thirds of the way down your procedure, nested into three levels of ifs and cases and loops, and then the violation of the assumption that the department ID is never null, the fact that the department ID is null, causes an error deep down in your code. That can be really tough to figure out. No problem, you might say. I'll just write an if statement. I'll check at the beginning of my program to see whether or not my department ID is null. So here's an example of asserting, verifying that your assumption is correct. If department ID is null, okay, well fine, that's bad. That should not have happened. I'm going to raise application error, pass it my -20,000, pass it the error message, and then stop. Now, the nice thing about this conceptually is that we check our validations, or we validate our assumptions at the top, and then after that, we can write what I would call normal code. You don't have to worry about whether or not department ID might be null or not, six different places in your code. You don't have to worry about, do I need to trap for no data found or this or that data condition? You verify your assumptions, and then you write your code in a much more straightforward and meaningful or understandable way. So conceptually, this is great. Practically speaking, not so great. Who's going to take the time to write all that stuff? You're not going to write that if statement all the time. You're not going to call raise application error. You're not going to sit there asking yourself, uh-oh, Should I call it with minus 20,000, minus 20,050? Do I call raise application error? Maybe I should call raise. Should I write a message out with DBMS output.putline? All these kinds of questions slow you down and get in the way of productive, high-quality coding. Instead, what you should do is agree with all your teammates that we're going to take a standard approach to doing assertions. We're going to create a predefined assertion package or set of routines that do all the work for us in a consistent fashion. We will not expose the mechanics of asserting raise application error, DBMS output.putline. We'll just call the procedure. And hopefully you'd agree that if you have three or four or five different assertions to make, assumptions to validate, being able to just say, hey, I want to assert that this is not null. Pass in the value that must be not null. Pass in the message that you want displayed to the user. And that's it. It's declarative programming. You're telling your engine, your development environment, what you want done without telling it how to do it, just like SQL. And the power of SQL expresses the power in your PLSQL code in the same way. You stay above the details. You stay more productive. Your code is more consistent. And I've provided an assertion package for you. So in DemoZip, pull out the assert package. And what I've done is create a whole bunch of high-level assertions. Assert that this is true. Assert that this is null. Assert that it's not null. Assert that the following expression is true or is false. And then, this is pretty good, check for date ranges. As you probably know, date range checking can be a pain in the neck because of the timestamp issues. Some of them have timestamps, some of them don't. So this way it's built in. You can, of course, add more to this or take some of it out, but the bottom line is that it's all done. And all my implementations, is null, is not null, is true, is false, and so on, all they do is call my main assert program. And my main assert program, well, that has all the details in it. Checking for nulls. If I want to display the call stack, then use DBMS output.putline. Otherwise, I just raise application error. You can make this as fancy as you want, and you can maintain it and change it in one place. And everything calls it. So that's just a tip for when you're building overloaded programs, or in general, when you're creating multiple programs with similar functionality. Do not copy-paste functionality. Create a single program, often an internal version that's not even in the package spec, that implements all the public programs. So assertions, a really great element to improve quality in your applications, make them much easier to maintain in the years as the years go by. And really, not very difficult to do. Very small amount of effort on your part. Tracing execution of your code. So this is probably the area where we are most clearly optimistic. We just think that we write great code, and you know, even if it's got bugs, it's not going to be that hard to figure out what went wrong. I can't tell you how many times I have run a piece of code in production or have users run a piece of code, and I can't even believe it. Have you ever looked at a bug that a user reported and said, that's impossible? We say these things, but of course, it's very possible. It just happened, but we can't believe it. How is this possible? And even worse, well, we can't reproduce it in dev or test. It's a production bug that we cannot figure out. And then, of course, the inclination of developers is to say to the users, oh, well, you know, just let us know if it happens again, which, of course, is not what they want to hear. So what's a developer to do? Well, certainly there are built-in pieces of functionality that you should take advantage of. There's built-in tracing, the Oracle Trace utility, and profiling. There are two different packages in PLSQL to profile execution of your code. Those are mostly useful for identifying the slow-performing areas and also doing some code coverage analysis. But again, they're entirely generic. They're not application-aware. So if we want to figure out what's going on in our production session, in other words, what's the value of that variable, we need to do something else. We need to trace or instrument our code. And what this essentially means is that you have to insert calls into your application to grab application state or the parts of it that you're interested in and save it to a table or a file or a screen, whatever makes the most sense. So here are some ideas I have for how to best trace your code. First of all, never, please, never put calls to DBMS output.putline directly in your application code. Maybe as a corporate citizen, as an employee of Oracle, I shouldn't say this, but let's face it, DBMS output.putline is very helpful, very useful. It's the only way you can get stuff displayed on your screen, but it has a number of drawbacks. and including you're not able to display Booleans, you can't display files just by passing it a file handle. You don't have very much flexibility. For example, and the data is not persistent. So the biggest problem for me from the standpoint of tracing is that when you call DBMS output.putline, it displays on the screen. Well, in production, you probably can't see the screen. And in any case, the data is then gone. I'd much rather almost always put my trace information into a database table with an autonomous transaction so that I can look at it later and run my analysis. Here's another tip. Always put calls to your trace program inside a Boolean expression to minimize overhead in production. I'll show you an example in just a moment. Don't comment out tracing when you move to production. So I hear this a lot from developers. Oh, I put DBMS output.putline all over my application. I got it to work. Now it's time to comment those out or pull them out of the code entirely. No, no, no. Your principle should be that you never take a trace call out. In other words, you're always adding to the tracing in your program. Tom Kite has said that he's pretty happy when the volume of trace logic instrumentation in his programs actually outnumber the lines of application code. That might be extreme, but the bottom line is that if you write it correctly so that you're not hitting a performance impact in production, the more tracing, the better. Do not remove tracing. Make it easy to switch between sending your trace information to your table, your screen, etc. So again, for production purposes, sending it to the table is absolutely required. When I'm running it in dev, sometimes it's a lot easier to just see it sent to the screen. And with my tracing utilities, I can just switch it in my session with basically changing a package variable. And build in the ability to turn on and off tracing in your application without modifying the code. This is critical. You can't obviously tell your users to get off the application so you can turn on tracing. You need to make it really easy to do and do it without their cooperation or perhaps even knowledge. So what should you do in terms of your tracing options? You can certainly build your own, and I've done that a number of times, and there are various packages inside my demo zip that do that. Whoops. There is the DBMS application info package, which is built in and available to everyone. And DBMS application info is great because it populates $V views, so you can actually watch dynamically as the application is running what is going on. It's especially helpful for long-running processes within your applications. There's also an open source logger utility, which is very popular, maintained by Martin D'Souza, and is often used with Apex development. So there are a number of tie-ins with Apex. In the demo zip files, you should be able to find the watch package. So the watch package creates tables and basically creates a UI so I can say send it to the screen, send it to the pipe, a database pipe, send it to a file, send it to a table, and you watch the action. So the watch package is something you might want to look at from me. But in general, just make sure you put something in your code to trace it. Building your own tracing mechanism is not hard to do. So let me show you one other piece of code before we finish up. Always put calls to trace inside a Boolean expression to minimize overhead in production. So let's show you what I'm talking about there. I spent the last 5 years working on an application called the PLSQL Challenge, which is a website that allows you to take quizzes on SQL, PLSQL, lots of stuff. Certainly check it out at plsqlchallenge.com. And it's built on a backend of PLSQL code. And as you might imagine, I wrote a lot of it. And so I did my tracing in it. Let's take a look. Here's a good example. So my procedure is called submit question survey. And what I want to do is trace some activity. I want to find out the user ID, the question ID that's passed in, the question survey ID that was looked up in my declaration section with a one row query. So I call trace activity. But notice I put them inside this if statement. Why did I do this? Well, if I just call trace activity by itself, like this, inside the trace activity program, it would check to see if tracing was turned on and enabled. It would even check this string, this context, to see if a filter was enabled to turn this on or off. So it's not going to trace information out to the table unless it's turned on, but to get inside QDB Utilities trace activity to check to see whether trace is enabled, Oracle first has to evaluate all the arguments. So in production, the user will pay the runtime cost of constructing that concatenation. And they could be much more complex statements involving function calls. So what I always do is put them inside my Boolean function. This does a very fast check. is tracing turned on? It doesn't look at the filter. It doesn't check for context. It simply checks the state of a Boolean variable or the content of a table row. Is tracing turned on? If so, then I'll absorb the overhead for these subcalls. And that's what I recommend you do in your own code. Sure, it makes it look it's bulkier than it perhaps needs to be. But if you've got a tool like SQL Developer, you can certainly hide the trace functionality and not have it bother you so much. And as you can see, there's a lot of this stuff in my application, lots of tracing going on. Here's a whole bunch of tracing, including function calls. Again, the sort of things that you do not want to hit every time you're running in production unless trace has been enabled. All right. Well, bulletproofing PLSQL, hopefully you would agree, it's really not that hard. First of all, Oracle PLSQL gives you lots of different features that help you manage how errors are both raised and handled, though we focused on the handling side today. The really key step is for you to set up guidelines about how the features should be applied. So it really doesn't come down so much to what the technology offers. What it comes down to more than anything else is the discipline that you and your team take in applying the features. So decide where and when and how you're going to handle exceptions. Do we have an exception handler in each sub-program unit? Do we have just one at the top? Inside each of those handlers, are we going to call those built-in functions, or are we going to have a generic error logging utility? Then set standards for execution tracing. You want to make sure that you trace parameter values, key algorithmic steps, etc., and do it proactively as you're building your code. Having said that, one of the nice things about execution tracing is that you can always go back in and add it later. It's not like you made some major design error in your normalized database structures that are hard to fix. You can always go back and add tracing. And again, build or install generic error logging and execution tracing utilities. It doesn't make sense for everybody to write these themselves over and over and over again. And it definitely doesn't make sense inside your exception handlers to call those individual functions. Always call a single procedure to do your log, call a single procedure to do your trace, call your functions to find out if trace is on or off. And consider establishing a new standard for block structure. Instead of just thinking about that executable section being this big blob of code, think about using nested subprograms to isolate initialization steps, cleanup steps, and assertion. Think of them as different sections or subsections within the exception or within the executable section. So to sum up, never stop learning, which I am sure you agree with since you are here to enjoy this webinar and or have just watched it. Please do consider what I've talked about as just a starting point. Coding is very abstract, and talking about code is even more abstract. So there's no way that you can fully internalize everything I've talked about, both concepts and features, from just watching for an hour. It's too passive. What you need to do is write code. Fortunately, we like to write code, right? It's a lot of fun. So use Oracle documentation to back you up. Download my demo zip file, use my scripts, try things out, and make sure they work the way I advertise. And let me know if they don't. And check out the PLSQL Learning Library for additional resources on PLSQL, and in general, the Oracle Learning Library for lots of resources about the many, many Oracle products out there for application developers. So oracle.com/OLL, search on PLSQL, or just look around. Thanks for joining me. I hope you have a lot of fun with Oracle technology in general and Oracle PLSQL specifically. Happy coding.